My view, Mr Speaker, is that to be a good government, you need to have a vision and you need to take practical steps to achieve that vision. Now, this government's vision is a fairer criminal justice system. It's a vision that, as I've said before, sees us rebalancing the scales of justice. It's a vision that sees us committed to justice for victims. It sees us crack down on meth dealers and serial killers. But our criminal justice system also needs to have the right degree of compassion. Our prisons should be for murderers, rapists and drug dealers. They should not be for single mums from disadvantaged backgrounds who can't afford to pay fines. In fact, the imprisonment of people for unpaid fines is, in my view, a failure of our justice system. I will call in support of that proposition from Principles of Sentencing by Geraldine McKenzie and Nigel Stobbs, the following propositions. They say at Chapter 3, punishment is carried out by the state on behalf of the community as a whole. The most important justification for the state punishing on behalf of the community in general is the maintenance of the rule of law. Now, as all members here would know, I am a great adherent and a great believer in the rule of law. I've mentioned it on numerous occasions. Now, ensuring that sentencing purposes are properly applied is an important part of ensuring consistency and fairness. We don't want to be imposing penalties that are disproportionate, because we need to make sure that as a parliament, we are preserving the community's trust and confidence in our criminal justice system. The reason you impose penalties, if I can quote from Problems of the Criminal Justice System by Roger Hawthorne and John Champion, is manifold. There are multiple reasons why you impose punishment. And starting at page 89, they are, when it comes to perpetrators of crime, retribution, incapacitation, deterrence, reform, and rehabilitation. Now, for people who have failed to pay a fine, oftentimes because they are impecunious or indigent, is incredibly disproportionate when you imprison them. So our criminal justice system begins to have its public confidence eroded if it's not applied correctly. So the community recognises that putting people in jail for not having paid a fine is not right. Furthermore, to quote from the eminent legal scholar Blackstone, we have the writ of habeas corpus that I was talking to the member for Hillary's about yesterday, which is what prevents you from being unreasonably detained, from that greatest imposition on your liberty, on your freedom. And as Blackstone said, that writ of habeas corpus is that great and efficacious writ in all manner of illegal confinement. And one of the great problems that we have with the current system is that people can have their liberty deprived in circumstances where they haven't had the opportunity to put their case before a judge or a magistrate. Bless you, Member Figueroa-Wayne. So we have prison for retribution, incapacitation, deterrence, reform and rehabilitation. Now, these aims in our criminal justice system, these aims in sentencing, these aims in imprisonment, ought not be applicable for a simple offence like an unpaid fine. Why, I hear members ask? The reason is contained or illuminated in the excellent peer review article that's already been referred to in the wonderful contribution from the member for Kalamunda. But just for the purposes of Hansard, this is from the International Journal of Crime, Justice and Social Democracy, The Hidden Punitiveness of Fines, authors Julia Quilter from the University of Wollongong and Russell Hogg from the... It's an excellent article, Member for Armidale, and I hope it gets a thorough working out in the contribution that members make to this debate. I'll try and avoid repetition, but there are a couple of points based on what the member for Kalamunda has already said, but there are a couple of points that I'd like to make. At page 12, the authors go to the attractions of a fine. A growing number of offences are now subject to infringement or penalty notice provisions. These opt-in measures, opposed by police and other agencies, require the offender to pay a nominated fine for the infringement in question, or elect a court hearing, usually with the prospect that, if unsuccessful, the penalty will be increased and court costs incurred. And they say further, fines are widely viewed as an ideal penalty, as simple, quick, efficient, flexible, effective and cheap form of punishment, easily understood and readily adjusted to reflect the seriousness of offence and the circumstances of the offender. Mr Acting Speaker, so far, so good. But what we see next is the growth in the use of the fine. In their classic study in 1939, Punishment and Social Structure, Ruscha and Kirkheimer identified the factors driving the growing ascendancy of the fine in the 20th century. Fines achieved a penal effect without costing the state. And I'll come back to that point. What is the cost to the state of these fines and the current regime that requires imprisonment for fine circumstances? The authors were, however, mindful of the difficulties that stood in the way of the full rationalisation of the penal system through the introduction of fines. Most importantly, the enforceability of fines against the indigent and how to maintain a semblance of equal justice if fines were converted to imprisonment in the case of those unable to pay. Picking up precisely on the point raised by the member for Hillary's, the paradox of forcing those who could least afford to pay the fine be liable for a fine and then sending them into jail where they couldn't pay the fine. And then another point, the same point was raised very well by the member for Kalamunda. In or out of court, fines are now and have been for some time by far the most frequently imposed penalty in Australia and many other countries. Over 60% of offenders sentenced in Australian criminal courts each year receive a monetary sanction as their principal penalty. However, the problem with this increasing use of fines is that, and I'm quoting from the article again here at page 20, the impact of converting fines to imprisonment has overwhelmingly been borne by women and by Aboriginal people. In 2013, one in every three women entering the prison system did so solely to clear fines. In relation to Aboriginal people, between 2008 and 2013, the number of incarcerated for fine default has increased from 101 to 590, a 480% growth. Now, given that the burden falls so squarely and so significantly on Aboriginal people, what then do we do? Well, as I said at the start, to be a good government, you need to have a vision and you need to take practical steps to achieve that vision. And if I can refer members to an article from the ABC earlier this year, titled, it was written by Rhiannon Shine, WA Premier Mark McGowan outlines 12 key targets that he says will define his job. And he says one of those targets is reducing the number of Aboriginal adults in prison by 23% by 2028-2029, a measurable, tangible, compassionate and worthwhile objective. So, we've already seen that the imposition of fines, imprisonment for unpaid fines, falls disproportionately on Aboriginal people. Well, what does the Australian Law Reform Commission have to say about incarceration rates of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people? Well, thankfully, the answer is contained in their discussion paper 84, 19th of July 2017, imprisonment terms that cut out fine defaults. And I'm here in for members' information, I'm here in Chapter 6. Imprisonment for the fine default results in punishment disproportionate to the offending conduct and contradicts the principle of imprisonment as a last resort. And Acting Speaker, when you have regard to the comments that I've already relayed from Messrs Hawthorne and Champion, you can see exactly what the Law Reform Commission is getting at. Nearly 30 years ago, in 1991, the Royal Commission into Aboriginal Deaths in Custody recommended that all governments ensure that sentences of imprisonment were not automatically imposed for the default of payment of a fine. Further, regimes that use warrants of commitment, which is exactly what the Western Australian regime does, that use warrants of commitment permit imprisonment without hearings or trials. So what happens to that great and efficacious writ, the writ of habeas corpus? These people are being imprisoned without hearings or trials. Imprisonment remains automatic at a certain point in the enforcement process. In 2016, the Coroner's Court of Western Australia questioned whether incarcerating fine defaulters provided any benefit to the community and recommended the abolition of warrants of commitment in WA. And the Western Australian system has been identified as particularly arduous for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander women. And again, the same statistic, in 2013, it was reported that one in every three women who entered prison in Western Australia did so as a result of fine default. These are laws that unreasonably and disproportionately unreasonably and disproportionately criminalise Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander women and recommend these laws are recommended for abolition. The Aboriginal Legal Service said complex and underlying problems that exist for vulnerable fine defaulters, such as mental illness, cognitive impairment, homelessness, poverty, substance abuse, family violence and unemployment, will never be addressed by the current blunt fines enforcement system of Western Australia. And the Law Council of Australia has indicated support for the national abolition of fine default for imprisonment schemes. That family violence in that list of concerns that the Aboriginal Legal Service spoke about is so much more pertinent when one has regard to the coroner's report in 2016 was in response to the death in custody of Miss Dew, who'd been imprisoned, 22-year-old Aboriginal woman who'd been imprisoned as a result of failure to pay $3,500 worth of fines. That's the price we're putting on a life, $3,500 in unpaid fines. She's in prison for that and she's now died in custody. Right? She was a victim of family and domestic violence. Right? Now, the Law Society, and I'll come back to that point if I have time in my contribution, Mr. Acting Speaker. The Law Society, so in addition to the Australian Law Reform Commission, clearly and unambiguously stating their support for the proposition that we should abolish imprisonment for fine default, which is what this legislation does, the Law Society of Western Australia, that eminent organisation, in their briefing paper from April 2019, said that the Fines, Penalties, Infringement Notices Enforcement Act has a, and I'm quoting here from this paper, from their briefing paper, discriminatory and disproportionate effect leading to the overrepresentation of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. The key findings of the 20th of May 2016 report from the Government of Western Australia Office of Inspector of Custodial Services made numerous findings which I won't traverse in the time that I have because time's running out, but I'd recommend a review of this paper to members. And then recommendation number four, the Fines, Penalties and Infringement Notices Enforcement Act is not consistent with the recommendations made in the Royal Commission into Aboriginal Deaths in Custody report. We're close to 30 years after the recommendation of that report. Now, again, some useful statistics for members in their deliberation on this particular legislation. 43% of 1,358 people who entered prison in WA solely for the purposes of clearing fine defaults in 2013 were Indigenous Australians. So the policy position is outlined by the Law Society at the end of the paper, and they summarise the Law Council's policy position. In January 2019, the Law Council of Australia released a joint statement with the Law Society of Western Australia, and I've got a copy of that, that statement here, calling on the state government to repeal laws that provide for imprisonment as a result of unpaid fines and outlining the disproportionate impact on people who experience significant disadvantage, including Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. So, members, you have the philosophical basis, you have the academic research, you have the policy position outlined by eminent organisations like the Australian Law Reform Commission, the Law Council of Australia, the WA Law Society. You can see that what this government is trying to achieve by bringing this legislation to this place is supported by such a broad cross-section of the community. Now, I wonder if I might have a short extension, Mr. Acting Speaker.
Extension granted.
Thank you, Acting Speaker. And I did say earlier in my contribution that I was going to refer to the joint statement from the Law Council and the Law Society. So their policy position I've already summarised, but they issued the following statement on the 26th of September 2019 in response to the government's announcement that it was bringing this legislation before the Parliament. The Law Society of Western Australia and the Law Council of Australia have welcomed the announcement by the Attorney-General, the Honourable John Quigley MLA, of proposed changes to the enforcement and recovery of fines in Western Australia. Law Society President said, I'm just skipping a paragraph so members know, Law Society President Greg McIntyre, who, as I've said previously, is a friend of mine, just for the declaration of interest, imprisonment for fine default has impacted adversely on the most vulnerable in our community, including Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, and has a huge cost socially and to the taxpayer. Replacement by debt recovery and community service options is welcome and will be far less costly to the community. And I did say, Acting Speaker, didn't I, that I would return to the economic argument. And this economic argument will be picked up by other speakers in their contributions to this debate. Law Council of Australia President Arthur Moses SC said imprisonment for fine default is an inherently disproportionate and ineffective punishment, which only serves to criminalise people living in poverty. This bill will bring Western Australia further in line with the recommendations of the ALRC in the Pathways to Justice report and the Law Council final report of the Justice Project, which called for the practice to be abolished in all jurisdictions. And, Mr Acting Speaker, I saw the member for Cottesloe pop his head in the chamber. I just want to thank the member for Cottesloe. He and I, together with the Honourable Alison Zamon from the Legislative Council, together hosted Social Reinvestment WA. And Social Reinvestment WA has produced a paper called The Review of Fines, Penalties, Infringement Notices Amendment Bill. And it says this: following our briefing and conversations with members of parliament on Tuesday the 17th of September on the pressing need for reform to WA's fine default legislation and the high profile imprisonment of another woman after reporting a burglary on the 24th of September, Social Reinvestment WA is pleased to see the Attorney General announce and bring before parliament the Fines, Penalties and Infringement Notices Enforcement Amendment Bill. We appreciate your involvement, et cetera, et cetera. So I just want to, can I commend the work, I just want to say a few thank yous. Can I commend the work of Social Reinvestment WA? Can I acknowledge the family of Ms. Jew, who I mentioned before? Can I acknowledge her her legal representative during the coronial inquiry, a friend of mine, the Honourable Peter Quinlan, SC Chief Justice of WA, for all of the work that he did? And if I may, can I just finish on a couple of points that were raised by the... And I don't want to do this because I'm incredibly grateful to the member for Hillary's for indicating that the Liberal Party will not oppose this legislation. But I just wanted to make a couple of points about how and why it is that this legislation is the right legislation at the right time by the government that is achieving its objectives, having outlined quite clearly to the community precisely what those objectives are. Now, the member for Hillary was concerned about those who were going to thumb their noses, was I think the language that he used, and I don't want to quote from uncorrected hindsight, but those who thumb their noses at the criminal justice system. And just quoting from the second reading speech, this is what the Attorney General had to say. It is important to note that this bill implements the alternative recommendation of the due inquiry and provides that imprisonment for fine default is still an option, however remote. It is important that imprisonment be available as a means of enforcement for the cohort of debtors who have the means but not the inclination to pay. Those recalcitrant few who thumb their noses at the system. So I think there was no accident in the language that was used by the member for Hillary's, because the Attorney General has used precisely the same terms. Those who thumb their noses at the system and accrue fines with no intention of paying them back, having ignored all other attempts at enforcement. This bill draws a careful distinction between those who can pay but refuse to do so and the many experiencing hardship who cannot pay and should not be further entrenched in poverty. So I think that despite the concerns of the member for Hillary's, this bill in fact achieves the objectives that it sets out to achieve. I said earlier that I was somewhat surprised by the contribution for the member for Hillary's, where he continually stated that his contribution was in his personal capacity, and he introduced this paradox that while he was confident that the legislation would pass the Legislative Assembly, he wasn't sure what would happen in the Legislative Council. And one could only hazard a guess as to what features might exist in the Legislative Council, perhaps amongst the members of the Legislative Council, who may take a different view to this legislation than that taken by those more moderate and more intellectual members of the Liberal Party, such as the member for Hillary's and those who've made contributions in support of the legislation in this place. The member for Hillary's did say something which did take me by surprise. He said that perhaps we could have been bolder. Perhaps this was a time when we would move beyond government operating in silos. And I just wanted to give the member for Hillary's and all members two examples of the way in which the McGowan government, time and again, has worked cooperatively and collaboratively. And I can only surmise that this cooperative, collaborative attitude by the McGowan government is a function and a reflection of the harmonious working relationship within Cabinet, perhaps in stark contrast to the days of Emperor Colin. But let me give you two examples. Jobs. In jobs, we have a Minister for Tourism assiduously and diligently working to diversify our economy and encourage more tourists to Western Australia. He is supported, no interjections, he was supported in that endeavour by a Minister for Education who is investing in TAFE in order to enable students to access those qualifications they will need for jobs in the tourism and hospitality industries. We have a Minister for Transport investing in those job-creating, congestion-busting projects which will drive jobs growth in Western Australia. So a Minister for Tourism, working with a Minister for Transport, working with a Minister for Education, all focused on the issue of what we can do to increase the number of jobs in Western Australia. On the issue of law and order, we have a Minister for Police working with an Attorney General, working with a Minister for Corrective Services, all doing what they can to improve and enhance community safety in our state. We have a Minister for Police who is actively and assiduously working to ensure that our serving officers have the resources and the protection they need in order to discharge their functions. We have an Attorney General who is strengthening our criminal justice system and strengthening our courts. And we have a Minister for Corrective Services who is revitalising our prison estate. So coordinated, cooperative, collaborative approaches within and amongst this Cabinet. And all of that work, all of that endeavour, all of that effort underpinned by a Premier and a Treasurer focused on those objectives, making sure our community is safe and making sure we are promoting and creating jobs in WA. A Premier and a Treasurer who are driving precisely the sorts of reforms that we need after such a long time of the Liberals being in office, and we wish to continue all of the work that we've done in that regard and keep serving the people of Western Australia. I commend the bill to the House. Thank you.